welcome to another episode of Flux Sagacity, my little online series about being strong, getting strong, pursuing strength, defining strength, maybe even competing with that strength. I have a couple things to talk about today. For those of you familiar with my history and being on YouTube for almost since the beginning and putting out DVDs and books and social media for ages and all that sort of stuff, you might recognize this hat. I've had this hat longer than I've had my YouTube channel, which is a very long time, and it has appeared in videos of mine for years. It's not a particularly good looking hat. It doesn't make me look any better, that's for sure, but it's the only one that fits my tiny little head. So I have my hat on today because it's actually a little chilly here in Texas, in Austin, surprisingly, but we're riding out the end of a little chill phase, and so I get my hat today, for what it's worth. Anyway, we're gonna talk a little bit about sandbags today in the use of training. In particular, we're gonna talk about how to properly clean a sandbag. And I don't mean clean it as in make it clean. I mean clean it as in get it to your shoulders. Although making it clean is also fairly important. Maybe we'll discuss that. But also, I got something in the mail. And we're gonna talk about that first as part of a bigger conversation. While I open my new box, let's talk a little bit about recovery. Recovery from your workout, recovery from life, just taking care of yourself in the sense of being able to return to a place of homeostasis, if you will, some sort of balance. We're trying to find the balance, and of course training, that stuff that we do where we're trying to create skill and strength, is actually a pretty big stress on the body. The good news is that movement practice is a stress relief. It's a tension release valve where we let the tension go. That's if you have a movement practice that is actually separate from your training. Your training just creates the ability to go have a movement practice. It isn't the entirety of your movement practice. And I'm going to stop moving and gesticulating so much with an open knife in my hand. But for you NCIS fans out there, rule number 9, so, recovery, being able to take the stresses of your day, which includes that training, that workout, we need to be able to take that, let it go. We need things in our life that are tension release valves. We create a lot of tension during our training, our workout, and we gotta let it go. We can't just carry that around all the time. And I got here a tool that's supposed to help with that. Now, I don't use these. I've never really used these types of things. Once or twice, but not to any regular degree. So I can't speak from a place of expertise or connoisseurship on this. This is called a RecoverFun. Plus, I'm not sure if there was a RecoverFun that was not a plus before this. I don't know if this is a bonus version of another product. RecoverFun, it's a massage gun. That's right, we gotta weaponize everything. Now, look, I'm not sure why people are excited about unboxing videos. This is my first unboxing video. I've always thought they were sort of silly. Why would anybody wanna watch somebody just open up a box and take stuff out? And yet, pretty sure we do that in real life all the time too. If you are at home and somebody else in your family gets a box, hell yeah, we gather around and take a look and are real curious as to what the secret in the box is. And I guess YouTube's the same way. We all wanna see what's in the box. And so, welcome to my first unboxing video. Even though I still might think they're a little silly, let's have some fun with it. You might not know this about me, you might even be the same way. I'm a giddy for luggage, for baggage, for backpacks and suitcases and camera bags. That stuff, watching, if you ever go to websites that sell that stuff, they always have a video on every bag they have. And that's like porn to me. I'll watch those videos and think, I want that bag, and I will eventually probably have it. I have had in my lifetime too many bags, too many backpacks that I never used, too many camera bags that just sat in rooms and didn't do anything, and too many suitcases and things that I just don't need. I don't know why I have this weird luggage fetish, but I do. This comes in a cool little case. I love things in little cases. I'm a fan of little cases. And here we go with our little case. right off the bat, I'm pretty excited. Has a little case. All right. Okay, so. What fun. I'm not quite sure how these things work or what they do. I know they're a modern form of myofascial release. So instead of somebody's elbow or fist or something, you can take something and dig it into you. Now, I've used the car buffer technique. Didn't like it very much. Didn't work for me very much. So we're going to see how a massage gun works. This one makes me feel like a CHP officer, and I'm going to tell you how fast you're going in your car. It's sturdy. I don't know what to compare it to. I've heard some of these go for $250, $300. I'm not entirely sure. But this feels solid as heck. This is a beefy piece of machinery. It comes with a bunch of different little accoutrements, little toys to go with it. This does make me feel like I might have a future in bringing out confessions in people. It needs to be charged. So I'm going to charge it, and then we'll meet right back here for some fun. But just really quick, let's look at some of these things. It's got this thing that looks like a clown nose. It's very solid, though. It's got a whole bunch of different little heads to it. Some of them that look... some of them that look... You make your own conclusion. I have no idea what this does. Anyway, we'll be back here in a minute. I don't think it needs much of a charge. In fact, I'm going to double check that, but we'll meet back here in just a minute. So let's talk about sandbags, specifically the Sandbag Clean, as I mentioned. If you've been following this channel, you'll know that I've been gearing up for a competition, a weightlifting competition, in Savannah later in November. I've decided that it's probably best to not do it right now. I feel my training's been going well. For my first competition as somebody in their 50s, I was really excited about it. And my first competition for it being 2020, I was also excited about that, since I usually compete 3, 4, 5 times a year of some sort of strength sport. But it just doesn't feel right being in big groups like that right now. It's a little nerve-wracking to be surrounded by a lot of people. Even if they're trying to social distance, when you're all stuck into one big place, and there's dozens and dozens of people moving around, and you're all sharing the same stuff, there's a contingent of people that are just not giving a damn about this pandemic, and it shows. And frankly, I'm going back and spending time with my mom, who's in her 80s, and I don't want to necessarily be a hugely increased risk factor for her. That's just irresponsible. I'm there with everybody in spirit. Have fun if you are doing it. I'm not judging anyone for it. I just feel like I've been tempting fate a little too much with all my travels and all my stuff, and I don't want to do that anymore. Anyway, I've done the COVID test several times, but I just feel it's not the right year to compete, to be in big groups like that. So with that being said, though, I'm still training pretty hard. I'm still having fun with the movements. I just don't get to play with a barbell that much these days. And that's fine. In fact, I felt good about the training. I felt good that even with this limited time that I had to get ready for the meet, I was gonna be ready. I felt my foundation strength was snapping. That's where the sandbag comes in, actually. We're gonna talk about the sandbag as a conduit for strength, as another tool to create the same type of strength that you can with the barbell, particularly with the same movement patterns as an Olympic lift. A barbell clean, I think, has a lot of crossover to other things. The ability to be able to explode in that way, change directions of the hips from the second to third pull, and be able to catch a weight and come out of it. All those things I actually think have a lot of benefit and crossover to other aspects of movement. If you don't have a barbell, though, you can use a lot of other things, and I think a sandbag clean is actually hugely effective if done well. Not just yanking it from the ground and getting it to your shoulders. It's not like, say, an axle in strongman competition where you can roll it up your entire body and continental it, as it's often called, to get it to your shoulders. Sure, there's probably some good crossover in that with doing that with a sandbag too. I think picking sandbags up off the ground in multiple ways is great. But in this particular case, we're going to focus specifically on doing it like an Olympic lift with a barbell. So we're going to replicate the movements, but not exactly mimic them, because you can't. The sandbag is its own beast. Now, you know, I like the Alpha Strong sandbag. If you've seen my recent Alpha Strong video in my Body Tribe Anywhere series, where I go to the Alpha Strong headquarters and I talk to Kathy, who created them, and then I do a little workout with them, You've seen me recently use them, but you might know that I've been using sandbags for years and years and years. One of the OG for sandbags. 20 years of sandbag use. And with that experience, Alpha Strong is the only one that really won't break if you abuse the crap out of it. Because, frankly, the beauty of a sandbag is you should be able to abuse it. You should be able to slam it. You should be able to throw it. You should be able to drop it regularly. And you can with the Alpha Strong. They don't just tell you you can, they encourage it. So, we are gonna drop this. In fact, dropping a sandbag is so much nicer than dropping a barbell. There's no thumpy thumpy, there's no super loud noise, there's just maybe a little thud. You can even use this at home or even in an apartment and not terribly disturb your neighbors. You could even drop it on your foot and it doesn't really bother you too much. Now, I keep talking about the barbell clean, and that's under the assumption that everyone knows what a barbell clean is or how a barbell clean works. And you might not. So not only shall I explain it just a little bit, but I'm also going to describe some pretty important differences about the sandbag. Barbell clean is often broken down into three sections. There's the first pull from the ground, where you're taking it from the ground to your knees. Boom. And the whole goal there is to push your knees back, turn on your hamstrings, like you're pulling the bowstring back to launch the arrow. It's setting up the explosive part, which is the second pull. So the first pull is usually a little slower, and it's anticipation for that second pull. Then the second pull is all about hip snap, and we've talked about hip snap in other videos. It's where the hips go from way back to way forward. You're not leaning back, but you are getting as tall as you can in that position. You might even come up on the toes quite a bit. So it's this explosion of the hips and the hamstrings. Then you immediately go into the third pull, where you drop under the weight, and that's actually the fastest part. So you get tall and then get immediately short. So first pull slow, second pull fast, third pull faster. Slow, fast, super fast, as we call it. That's not gonna change with the sandbag, but how the pulls work will change a little. The first pull is almost non-existent. It's so small. It's a very short pull. In fact, it's mostly just getting tension going by getting those handles off the ground, because it takes a while to get these handles from here to here. There's no bag there, there's no weight there, but you're still creating tension. So the first pull is almost entirely with the bag still on the ground. Then the second pull starts pretty low. So it's more second pull than first pull by far. The reason I mention this and the reason it's important, you don't have to know the technique directly, you don't have to get into the nitpickiness of it, but what I don't want people doing is grabbing the handles and then yanking. Because as soon as you yank, that's a lot of weight and force and stuff and torque in joints. That ain't so good for the body. In other words, just please don't just yank the bag from the ground. Create that little bit of tension first, then explode. That's one of the big crucial parts that I'm trying to get across right now when using a sandbag. You're not just trying to yank it off the ground, you're trying to create some tension, then explode. Which leads to skills that have a lot of crossover to other things. Take that time to create that tension by pushing the knees back. So it's slow and getting the handles up, ready to go. Then I can launch. But there's no little pre-bounce, nor am I just grabbing it and going. So it's tension, pop, get under it. Those are the three basics. I'll do it one more time. Tension, pop, get under it. Tension, pop, get under it. If you are a weightlifter and you use a barbell, you're gonna notice the differences, but you'll also notice the very important similarities. Because of the handles and where the weight is and all that stuff, the first pull starts a lot later, so it's shorter. It doesn't even start until my hands are almost to my knees, which means the second pull gets going when I'm almost at full extension, if I were to treat it like a barbell. So I have to start the second pull sooner. First pull shorter, second pull weirder. Not only does it start sooner, but it's not going to get as high. The third pull, complicated. I have to get under this bag that's floppy, that's not going very high, and it's gonna catch weird on my arms. In fact, that's one thing I need to point out. The first version of this, we're gonna catch it. We're gonna actually let go of the handles and catch it. So, first pull short, second pull weird, third pull complicated. Caught it, stand up, elbows high, boom. That, to me, is a quintessential sandbag clean. It has all those beautiful components of a barbell lift. It has all the transferable components of a barbell lift, but it's weirder, and it's gonna have a slightly different outcome. Now, catching it, that's my favorite, but you're not gonna be able to press it, really, from that position. You can still squat it, you can still carry it. There's a lot you can do once you have it here, or you can just reproduce the clean. But if you want to press it, you're going to have to rack it a little differently. There's two versions of this. One I prefer way over the other one, but that's personal preference. You might like, I don't know which one you like, play with them. The first version, it's going to come up, flip over my hands, and I'll catch it with the hand. I can't even really describe it. You'll see. It looks like this. I'm going to start by grabbing the handle a little bit towards the end. So instead of in the middle, I'm coming towards me a little bit. And you'll see why. I flipped it over. Now I can press it. So it actually flipped over my hands and racked on my shoulders. And my hands were holding the handles in a way that allowed me to press it. I'll do it one more time. Hands a little bit closer to me. Pop, flip, grab, press. That's not the method I prefer. I'm gonna try to catch it with the bag on top. This is a little trickier, but if I can get the bag to land on my knuckles, it's an easier press. Doesn't feel as odd. It's actually even more comfortable on the hands. So now I have to grab the handles right in the middle, and I'm also gonna try to time it so it lands right on the middle on top of my hand. Hands right in the middle of the bag. The one drawback of sandbags would be for people with mobility issues in the shoulder, because it's a narrow press if you're using the handles. We're used to a little wider position with a barbell usually. And then there's that whole segment of the population whose shoulders won't allow them to come through no matter where their arms are. So the sandbag as an overhead tool might not work very well. But that's a different story. We're not talking too much about pressing today. We're talking about the clean. So those are the three versions of catching the clean. Catching it, my favorite. Handles, flipping it over, and landing on the top, right in the middle, on your knuckles. And yes, of course you can power clean the darn thing. Just pop it right on up, boom, and catch it. But again, I'm trying to mimic the benefits of the barbell clean, the full clean, the experience of not only exploding up, but then being able to pull yourself back down and then come up from a deep squat. I think all those things are truly beneficial. Power clean has its place, full clean, to me and my pantheon of choices, has a bigger place. So, pop and catch, that's my goal. Pop, catch. Pop, catch. Now keep in mind, sandbag weight, way different than barbell weight. Sandbag weight, more condensed and floppy. A sandbag is gonna feel heavier. So you're not gonna use a sandbag that's probably anywhere near what your barbell clean is. So I can't directly reproduce pound for pound the barbell version of the clean with the sandbag. Of course, in strongman comps, we gotta get really heavy sandbags up. That's a whole different story. It's almost more like a stone lift. But in this case, we're trying to use the sandbag to create the same type of movement skills as we do with the barbell clean. So you're gonna go lighter, just letting you know. And you can do it with kettlebells and dumbbells, but that's just a different story. Today we're talking about sandbags. Got a little bit of charge in here. In fact, it charged pretty quick. I'm not sure if the battery was entirely drained. So we got the radar gun toy. And as I mentioned, we have a bunch of little things for it. I think they just slide on in. There's no direction, so I'm thinking it's pretty user friendly. Oh, there's a charging. Yeah, there's charging and basic operating, but actually that's kind of nice. It doesn't come with like a little manual of how to use each one on what body part, because those things are always trash. Like when you buy a new piece of exercise equipment and there's always that little manual that they tuck inside that tries to tell you how to use that piece of exercise equipment. And it always looks like some cheap piece of crap that you pull out of a physical therapist drawer that has stick figures basically trying to use the apparatus. Those are always junk. And so I'm glad it didn't come with something like that. I'm hoping it's self-explanatory. Again, I've never used one of these before. Turn it on. Buttons on the back. Apparently, I push this. Can you hear that? Okay, so I see one little blue dot. It's got five potential blue dots, so let's... It's a five-speed vibrator. The problem I've had with other things like this, now I haven't used a massage gun necessarily, but I've used, I've used carb buffers, and they just don't work well. They feel really weird when I use them, and then they end up cramping my muscles. I know there's going to be a comment thread of, you're not using them right. No, I probably am not, but... Now, my calves are ultra-sensitive. Like, I have to tell massage therapists to go real gentle with calves, and then they can dig in slowly, but it takes them a while to work into it. Okay. But I like controlling this. I have complete control over this. Oh, yeah, I can... Oh, I can dig in. Wow, okay, that's level one. Yeah, I'm just going to crank it. I'm just going to five, see how this works. Okay, that might be too much for that spot. Let's try something like my IT band. Oh, yeah, I can do that with the IT band. Okay, I'm digging this. This is just one... I love this little round knobby thingy. That's nice. Okay, I think... Hold on. Okay. I think this is supposed to be the main tool because it sort of comes separately and it looks like it's supposed to be the featured tool. Let's just see. It's just sort of a half-round plastic ball. I really like whatever that was. Try the traps. I can't see the camera right now because my head's vibrating. That's nice though. I'm looking at the camera and it's just doing this. Okay. All right, I have magic sweet spot right here. One of the drawbacks of using the carb buffer was that it was so hard to hold in one spot. It kept wanting to move, or it kept wanting to bounce off. Like, it didn't feel like you got that good dig. This gets a dig. This is like somebody's knuckle or elbow doing that. Many years ago, I worked with a woman named Bonnie Prudden. If you don't know who she is, that's a bummer, because she is a legend and a fascinating woman. Unfortunately, she died in her 90s a few years ago, but towards the last few years of her life, I got to know her and work with her, and she taught me quite a few interesting things about myofascial release. And she gave me this great little tool, just a wooden dowel that slips between your fingers, and you hold it and you dig into these spots. And I love that thing. I still use that thing to this day. This, I think she would approve of this. I would have loved to have had that conversation with her, but I think she would have approved of this. She, by the way, is one of the original advocates of myofascial release. She wrote a book many years ago that's still in print, still popular. Every massage therapist and most physical therapists I know have a copy or should have a copy, called Myotherapy. Someday I'm gonna get around to doing the documentary about her life because it's fascinating. There's another guy named Ron Jones who likes her stuff and does a lot with physical culture history. And I think the two of us are gonna team up and take the hours of footage I have of me interviewing her and put it to some good use, because she was a fascinating woman. But anyway, look up Bonnie Prudden, although you won't find a lot online. But look up her book, Myotherapy. It's still a great book to learn about how myofascial release works. With that being said, I think she'd love this tool. So far, I'm digging it. I gotta try this one little setting. Just really curious how this works. I'm just gonna take a guess that it goes in the traps, or can go in the traps. Yeah, that's fun. And on each side of the Achilles. Oh my. Wow. Okay, I'm going to enjoy the heck out of this thing. This is, speaking of recovery, this is going to be a great tool to add to my recovery. Please take a look at your recovery. What are you doing? What are you doing when you're not working out? What are you doing with your eating? What are you doing with your resting? What are you doing with your movement practice? Not your workout, but your movement practice. Remember, we train to have a movement practice. Your training isn't necessarily your entire movement practice. What are you doing to let tension go? Might require a toy like this. Hopefully something like this, though, is not your only tool. I know everybody has something like this. I know almost everybody I know has some sort of foam roller in the corner of their house that they never use, collecting dust. hopefully you have some tool that you use with some occasion, some frequency, but it's not the only thing. Hopefully you're eating for your body to make sure it can recover, build muscle, get rid of tension, get rid of stress. Food can do that, but you have to figure out which ones work best for you, because every one of us is a little different. I'm going to talk about eating in an upcoming video, by the way, so I know you can't wait. What are you doing to sleep? Is there ever a chance for you to wake up without an alarm clock? Do you get to sleep in ever? Do you get to bed at a decent hour? Do you get to nap? Naps! One of the greatest things adults can covet is a good nap. Do you have pets that you can hang out with? Do you have people that you can hang out with? Do you have a social network involving animals and or people that can help you release tension? What are your tension release valves? Let me know how you actually recover, how you find balance from the stress of life and the stress of working out to not just carry it around with you all the time. Something like this. It's called the RecoverFun Plus. Wow. I'm going to spend some time with this. In fact, I'll give you a little update in a future video of how this is working for me. So, until then, thanks for joining me. Thanks for playing. Thanks for playing with a sandbag. And we'll see you soon. Please subscribe. All right. Bye.